In De Bierjager gaat Michael Jackson vandaag op zoek naar de wortels van dat lichte bier.
Drinking beer from one of the world's classic breweries in one of the world's greatest brewing nations. The beer is Pilsner. The nation is Bohemia. This is Prague, the capital of Bohemia. Bohemia has 1,000 years of brewing tradition. It may be the oldest beer region in Europe, and it's certainly the birthplace of modern brewing. Bohemia, once the kingdom of Wenceslas, is today the heart of modern Czechoslovakia. One of its towns, Pilsen, gives its name to the world's most widely produced beer style. Another Bohemian town gives its name to the world's biggest selling brand of beer. From the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters, this Bud was made for you and me. Well, not exactly this Budweiser, because this Budweiser was made in the town of Budweis. And as you can see, Budweis is not in the United States. In Czech, the town of Budweis is called Česká Budějovice. Budweis has been a brewing center since the 1200s. It had the Bohemian Royal Brewery in the 1500s. And in 1876, the celebrated beers of Budweis inspired America's first mass market brewer. He decided to call his American beer Budweiser. In Budweis today, the Budvar Brewery makes a beer called Budweiser Budvar. They consider theirs to be the original, even though this particular brewery was not established until 1895. Although they share a name and are similar in style, the Czech and American beers are separate products, each with its own character. The Czech brewers start out with some built-in advantages. Budweis became a brewing center for good reason. Beneath this brew house, there are wells producing some of the cleanest and softest brewing water to be found anywhere. Their malting barley from Moravia in the east of Czechoslovakia is renowned throughout the world of brewing. So are their hops from the west and north of Bohemia. In this magnificent copper vessel, the sweet malts of Moravia meet the soft water of Budweis. Lots of lager brewers would be happy to do that by a simple infusion. But here at Budweiser Budvar, they use the traditional continental method. It's rather grandly called double decoction. It takes 6 hours. It's a lot of trouble. But they say it's worth the trouble because it imparts just that extra little malt character to the finished beer. And in this equally handsome copper vessel, the juices of the malt meet the hops of Bohemia. Many modern brewers use hop extracts or hop pellets. At Budweiser Budvar, as you can see, they use the whole flower of the hop. Almost all brewers boil their brew for an hour and a half, but at Budweiser Budvar, they boil for 2 hours. They say these extra little bits of trouble and extra time give them a beer with just that bit more hop character and just that bit more brightness.
Extra trouble and extra time are the hallmarks of Czech brewing. Nowhere is this more evident than in the process of maturation, or lagering. Some lager brewers are content to mature their beers for less than 3 weeks. Budweiser Budvar has the classic 3 months. There's another refinement during lagering. Young beer is added to the brew to create a secondary fermentation and a soft, natural carbonation.
During its 3 months in the lagering tank, the beer gains its sparkle and its clarity. Of course, I can't see that in this sampling vessel, but I can taste the beer. There's nothing quite as fresh tasting as beer straight out of the lagering tank without any filtration. And there's nothing quite as creamy as the beers I've tasted in Czechoslovakia. The Czech brewers say that it's a long lagering time that gives their beers their creaminess and their very, very dense head. And they like to demonstrate this by placing a coin on top of the head of the beer and saying, look, our beer is so good that it even keeps our currency afloat. And it does.
Budweiser Budvar is widely exported and enjoys considerable success with the otherwise chauvinistic beer drinkers of West Germany. However, the Czech and American Budweisers are rarely to be found on the same shelf. The two companies have, over the years, been in several court cases over the right to use the label Budweiser. In Britain, a judge delivered the benevolent opinion that they could both use the name. With its royal pedigree, the Czech brew is known as the Beer of Kings. With New World swagger, the American brew calls itself the King of Beer.
Can both of the Budweisers find a way of existing together in the world? Can you find a modus vivendi?
Obě piva v současné době existují na společném trhu v Anglii, kde se prodává jak teda československý Budweiser Budvar, tak i americký Budweiser, lépe řečeno Budweiser. Snahou americké společnosti je prodávat svůj Budweiser na evropských trzích a za tím účelem se v současné době vedou mezi naším pivovarem a společností Anheuser-Busch složitá jednání.
This may seem a rather obvious question, but from your viewpoint, which is the best Budweiser beer?
No, my si myslíme, že náš Budweiser je nejlepší pivo. Americké pivo má samozřejmě svoji kvalitu, ale evropský konzument podle mého názoru je zvyklý na pivo typu našeho Budweiser Budvaru.
Czech Budweiser is a little fuller in both body and flavor than its American namesake, both maltier and hoppier, although the Americans do like to add a dash of Czech hops. Czech hops are used all over the world, even in other hop-growing countries. The hops are the seasoning in beer, but the basic raw material is barley malt. The Czechs have excellent barley, and they use very traditional means of turning it into malt. First, the corns of barley are soaked for 3 days. Then they're spread out on stone floors to germinate in cool, arched, almost Gothic cellars. The barley corns have to be turned constantly to keep them separate, cool and aerated. There are more mechanized systems, but many Czech maltings still use the old floor method. The same system can be found in some of the more remote Scottish malt whisky distilleries. As the barley begins to sprout, it's ready to give off its natural fermentable sugars. Then it's dried to a crunchy, biscuity consistency. Malt is one of the life forces in every beer. You should be able to taste it in every glass.
This malt has been dried in a kiln. When the maltster dries his malt like this, he can make it golden and clean tasting. He can make it amber and sweet, or dark and roasty like coffee. And each of these different styles of malt will eventually contribute to a different style of beer. The golden, clean-tasting malt they make here is known to brewers all over the world as Pilsner malt, and there's a good reason for that. The world's first golden-coloured beer was made at this brewery in Pilsen, Bohemia, in 1842. It was an instant success, and breweries all over the world copied it. Even today, if you look at the small print on the label of a famous lager beer, like a Heineken or a Carlsberg, or even a can of Miller Lite, you'll see the phrase Pilsner beer or Pilsner lager. But there's only one original Pilsner, and it's still made here at this brewery. It's called Pilsner Urquell, and that translates quite simply as Pilsner beer from the original source.
I love exploring old breweries that have grown up over the years. They're always such a jumble of architectural styles. A dash of grandeur here, a thump of industrial brutalism there, a cozy corner, a mysterious structure. They have the same fascination as big railway stations. Pilsner Urquell is like a sprawling city of beer. All movement and muscularity and people going about their own curious concerns. There's a hidden city too, under the ground. That's the bit I like best. 9 kilometres of corridor were cut into the sandstone underneath the town of Pilsen when this brewery was built. It's a cold, shadowy, seemingly deserted place. There is life down here, of a primitive micro-organic kind. Pilsen's yeast working its way through an underground journey of fermentation in line after line of oak vessels. There are 1,500 of them, some over 80 years old. No other brewery in the world has anything like as many open fermenters. Hardly any use wooden fermenters at all, especially uncoated wood. The cleaning and maintenance of these vessels is a nightmare, but they provide a unique microclimate for Pilsen's extraordinary 5-strain yeast and a crucial rendezvous on the road to a remarkably complex beer. When the beer is in the fermenters, it's full of enough living yeast to coexist with any microorganisms in the wood. When it goes into the lagering vessels for a longer 3-month stay, no such risks can be taken. There are 3,500 of these vessels in gallery after gallery. They too are made of oak. Each vessel is lined with a protective inner coating of pitch and can be only used for one brew before it must be brought back to the surface and repitched. In the echoing, dripping half-light, the beer hunter can feel like a hunted man. When they're full, the lagering vessels can each contain 5,000 litres of beer. When they're empty, each demands the attention of 2 or 3 workers as it rolls majestically through the brewery. The lagering vessels are a commanding presence at Pilsen, both below and above the ground, and they have their own character-building rituals. In this fire-eating performance, the vessels have their old coating of pitch burnt out and melted. Nowhere else is there a brewery with such a fiery facility. When the inside has been stripped down to the wood, molten new pitch is applied. Then the vessels are rolled until the coating is spread into every crack and cranny. The process looks medieval, but it's another moment in the forging of a unique beer. The journey through the brewery ends here, the most serene place in Pilsen, the tasting room.
Lots of lager brewers seem to feel that any golden-coloured lager can be called a Pilsner, but a really good example of the style should have an alcohol content of between 4 and 5% by volume, a herbal, flowery hop aroma, and a long, dry, hoppy finish. There are good examples, of course, but for me, none has got quite the complexity and individuality of this one, the original.
When the original Pilsner beer was first produced, it was the beginning of a new age in brewing. And today, golden lagers are still regarded as the most modern style of beer all over the world. Right down to the making of its own lagering vessels, the original brewery retains the craftsmanship that shaped its beer in the golden age. It's an expensive and time-consuming way to make beer, but the brewery is, in the language of modern business, quality-led. Pilsner beer first caught the public imagination because it was clear and golden at a time when all other beers were cloudy and dark. Clarity and colour became an issue when stoneware steins gave way to mass-produced glass. It's a product that goes hand in hand with beer. The Bohemians were leaders in that field, but they're still better known for their hand-blown crystal. Glass blowers, working in conditions of intense heat, are among several categories of employees in Czechoslovakia who are given a special dispensation to drink beer while they work. In the heat of this foundry, workers have the same dispensation. They slake their thirst with Pilsner beer, but with a low-strength version. It's a small beer, but a cherished one. The Bohemians have an intimate, fond relationship with beer. They have almost as many words for beer as the Eskimos have for ice. And half of modern Czech literature, from Hacek to Hrabal, seems to be set in taverns. One of the best-loved literary taverns is the Golden Tiger in Prague. One of its habitués is journalist Ange Hamer.
Is the Czech culture really a culture of a beer culture or a tavern culture, actually?
Well, it's certainly better to drink draft beer in the pub than drink bottled beer at home and watch television, I dare say. And I think Czechs are very friendly people who like to socialize, and that's why they go to pubs and drink beer and talk about things.
What do they talk about in town?
What do they talk about?
Yeah.
Well, the meaning of life, international politics, and soccer, naturally.
And
they all know what's the best solution.
In Britain, I think beer is a social phenomenon. In Belgium, it's a gastronomic phenomenon. In Germany, it's almost a religious phenomenon. What is it in Czechoslovakia?
Well, with a pinch of salt, you can say that it's a philosophical phenomenon here. The Czechs are known from political history not to rush into things. They like to be conservative about changes. And I think beer helps in that respect. It's a thing that gets you moving slowly, rolling, rather than rushing. And in times of great decisions, Czechs usually have another beer.
Such a decisive moment was a turning point in the story of the good soldier Švejk, the Czech's national hero. Švejk failed to join his regiment because, in his words, "It happened to me that I drank one beer after another."
Go!
Even when decisions are concluded, they tend to be sealed with a beer. At a traditional Bohemian wedding, Bohemia's great traditional drink adds its own music to the ritual. How will this marriage be blessed? The Czechs have a heartfelt earnestness about such matters, as you can see from this elegant inscription on the walls of a famous Prague tavern. Blessed is the mother who gives birth to a brewer. The customers have been bearing witness to that for quite some time, drinking a style of beer that's older than Pilsner Urquell or Budweiser Budvar.
One of the social rituals of Prague is a glass of this very spicy dark lager and a snack of this extremely smelly cheese at this old tavern. They call it U Fleku, after the Flakovsky family, who founded it in 1499. It's the only place you can buy the U Fleku beer. They make it upstairs. And this place is the oldest homebrew pub anywhere in the world.
U Fleku brings together under one roof the Czech devotion both to taverns and to breweries. In the nation's capital, it's a living example of both, dating from the Holy Roman Empire, yet constantly, imperceptibly renewed.
As you can see, it's a very traditional looking brew house. After all, they have been making beer here for 500 years continuously. But 5 years ago, they refitted the whole place, spent quite a bit of money on it. And so far as I can see, they haven't changed a thing.
Not much changes in the fabric of Prague either. These are the streets trodden by Smetana and Dvořák, Kafka and Einstein. The buildings gently crumble, and are almost as slowly renovated. In a couple of dozen great beer taverns, the debates roll on. The Czech novelist Josef Skorecký once said that the Bohemians seem to be solving the mystery of human existence when they talk about beer. In Bohemia, there are some fine beers to talk about, some wonderful beers to hunt down and to protect.
The Kingdom of Wenceslas has many claims to being one of the greatest brewing regions. Whenever I visit a brewery in Czechoslovakia, especially one like Pilsner Urquell, I feel less of a beer hunter than a conservationist. As the Eastern European countries become more economically competitive, there's bound to be pressure on the Czechs to modify or abandon their very traditional brewing methods. I hope they don't. It may seem heresy to suggest this, but I'd rather they charge more for their beer, at least in export markets. After all, you don't expect a bottle of Montrachet for the price of a table wine.
Op zijn zoektocht naar de wonderenwereld van het bier doet gids Michael Jackson volgende week Nederland aan. Hij bezoekt een trappistenklooster in de buurt van Tilburg.